Hey everybody, welcome to Retrogame Roadshow Pax West 2016. Sunday night. Thank you for making us your favorite entertainment here at Sunday night. This is Retro Game Roadshow. Are your old games really buried treasure? The answer, maybe. and just in case you don't know, yes, we're playing off of the PBS show, as so many great PAX panels do, playing off of the PBS show, Antiques Roadshow. In which people bring things that their grandmother or their great-great-grandmother owned and they find out that they're worth $1 million. In this case, you're probably bringing something that you bought to find out that it's worth maybe a few $100 if you're super lucky. But we have our panel of video game collecting experts / obsessives, beginning with, of course, myself. Hello, I'm Chris Kohler. I'm games editor at Wired. That is me in my old house. New house has the exact same IKEA shelves with the exact same games on them. I don't just sit around stacking up Atari games all day. This was posed. And then with me here on the panel are two of the Seattle area's absolute fixtures in the Seattle retro gaming community. First, all the way on the end, it's Kinsey Burke, ladies and gentlemen. Hello.
Thank you.
One of the, you work with the Seattle Retro Gaming Expo?
I do most of their social media, so, yeah.
You can be seen on YouTube a lot?
Occasionally, you'll see me on there.
And you are quite the video game collector also.
You could say that.
What are some of the more interesting things in your collection?
Lately, I've been obsessing over getting all of the Sailor Moon games, so we all have to have our niche.
Yes. And then sitting between us, you're going to want to get his autograph because his name is John Hancock. Boo.
Terrible joke. Yeah. Never heard that one.
Really? You've never gotten that joke before ever in your whole life?
So, never. Never.
So, okay. All right. So I collect video games and Kinsey collects video games and you guys collect video games. But, John, you really collect video games.
Yep.
Let's go over some stats here. How many complete sets do you have where you have the full run of a system's library?
Full run defined by at least a cart or disc of each game in the collection. I have 25 complete North American collections. And some of those consist of Sega Dreamcast, N64, complete in box, Vectrex, Sega Genesis, Nintendo, including a loose stadium events, but I have it. Weird stuff like the Microvision, RCA Studio 2, APF M1000, stuff you're like, I didn't even know that existed. but, you know, encompassing a wide variety of systems across 35 years. Mm-hmm. And I collect other stuff, too. I just completed my TurboGrafx collection, and I scored a cart and manual for Magical Chase US.
That's a tough one to get.
That's why I've got here.
So, yes, hopefully I've now proven to you that we know what we're talking about, or at least we used to know what we were talking about. Because, you know, sometimes what happens is, as we were kind of discussing before the panel, is once you acquire something for your collection, you don't track the price of it as much anymore. And it can be very, very surprising. What was the game Troubleshooter for the Sega Genesis?
Yep.
A complete, like, nothing of a game that nobody really remembers. It's a good game, right?
It is,
but it's
a good
like,
game.
Who even knows about this game? And when I got it for, I don't know, $10 a couple of years ago on the Genesis. I was like, oh, okay, I'll buy this. What is it going for on eBay now?
Anywhere from like $180 to $300.
Yeah.
Insane.
It is insane right now what is happening to some prices. So we're going to do our best to evaluate the items that you, the audience, have brought. Now, we were out there working the line for some of you guys who showed up early, so we have a few names written down. If you didn't talk to John, but you actually did bring something, we'll get to you later on, and we'll just, you know, we'll have you raise your hand. Time permitting, we may have a Q&A session about, you know, the current state of video game collecting. And there was kind of like one thing that I wanted to talk about, because we always kick these shows off with some sort of a State of the Union address. When you're trying to predict, when you're trying to look at what's going on with video game collecting, the prices of old video games, and trying to get a sense of, okay, well, what's going to happen with prices of certain things? We understand that prices for things are set by supply and demand, and so really the question that you're asking is, if some event happens How is that event going to change the supply of games that are out there? And how is that event going to change the demand for the games that are out there? And things are constantly happening all the time. One of the big drivers of demand is awareness. That's why, you know, stadium events, right? When there was a big, the first time an article about stadium events blew up, you know, back in like 2010 maybe, the first time like something really kind of catches the public's eye, that's when prices can start to increase because more people start becoming aware that these things are out there, that they're worth money, and more people sort of get into the game and start buying things because they kind of see the prices going up. And so I like looking for big events. And as it happens, there is an event happening this year that I absolutely think is going to increase awareness of, thus increasing demand for old video games, specifically old Nintendo video games, which is the NES Classic Edition, which Nintendo is going to release. If you haven't seen this yet, they've actually got one here in their booth at PAX. And awesome. It looks beautiful. It looks really cool.
It looks awesome.
It's this tiny little fits in the palm of your hand. It looks like an NES. It, you know, doesn't take cartridges or anything. It just has 30 built-in games. HDMI. The controller looks perfect to me. I don't think anybody's like played with this controller yet, but it looks really good. The important part about this is not just that this product exists, right? Because there's, you know, there's the Retron 5 systems that play old NES games. There's all kinds of things. But Nintendo is putting a lot of effort into marketing this thing, or certainly is going to. You know, you're going to see commercials for this thing. I kind of feel like, you know, depending on how many of these that Nintendo can produce for this year, that this really has the potential to be like this year's Tickle Me Elmo. Like this really could be a hot, hot Christmas present for this year because it's super cheap. It is absolutely like grab one when you're in the checkout line at Toys R Us level of like impulse buy prices for a Christmas present. Nintendo is really going to be making people aware that this exists. It's capitalizing on the already kind of going on like existing demand for the NES because, you know, the NES kids, they're 30, they're 40, they have more money. But just in general, it's going to make a lot. News of this thing will reach millions and millions of people, and it's going to make them think, oh, yeah, old NES games, those are fun. I want to play Double Dribble. Was Double Dribble on this? Well, no, it's not. Oh, okay, I'm going to go down to the local retro store, and I'm going to buy an old NES and, you know, copy a Double Dribble so I can play that again. And that is definitely going to start happening. So I will absolutely predict, no question, I think, in my mind, that we will see NES stuff and just classic stuff in general have another price increase later on this year due to this.
Yeah, and it actually comes at an interesting time because I feel like the NES bubble kind of already happened. It's kind of started to level off. And so now we're kind of in this Super Nintendo is really expensive. So is it going to make the bubble go backwards, which is kind of strange for the way these prices go. So it'll be really interesting to see what happens.
Well, and tying into awareness, sometimes awareness is like a spark, and it can just, people remember, oh, I remember that, and then they start researching, and then it's like, it can be like wildfire sometimes. Oh, I have that in my attic, right? My grandma still has our old video game stuff, and so that really, sometimes awareness can be the spark of really making the value of something skyrocket, at least temporarily, and sometimes over time it levels down again, but
definitely.
Oftentimes, it doesn't always go back down to where it started. It usually ends up a little bit higher than it was.
Right.
It stays there.
And it will. I mean, you know, we've seen, and I know, I think I've talked about this, you know, on Retro Game Roadshow's past about Atari, where, I mean, there really was 10 years ago a massive boom in the prices of Atari 2600 stuff, which did go down. And whenever I say this, I have to remind myself that the super top-end Atari stuff, you know, the really, really rare, nice, complete-in-box Atari stuff, that keeps going up because that stuff truly is rare. But, I mean, it used to be, I mean, we'd go to Classic Gaming Expo, and it'd be like, oh, a copy of, you know, Pitfall, loose cartridge, you know, $20.
Yeah.
And it was getting those kinds of prices, and that really, that did come down.
Yeah, and definitely eBay changed a lot of that with Atari. When it first came, Atari 2600, when eBay first existed, you could sell a loose system for like a couple hundred bucks. Well, now, you know, people now realize how many Ataris are actually out there. I think over 30 million were produced.
There were a lot.
Yeah.
And the demand's gone down because, you know, a lot of people that grew up with Nintendo, that's too simple for them, graphic-wise or gameplay-wise or something else.
Right. So all things will come down eventually, and it's really when it's that like everybody's turning 30, everybody's turning 40. Okay, well, number 50, and maybe we wouldn't want to hold on to this stuff anymore that we kind of bought when we were 30. So it does definitely come down. But then again, sometimes it doesn't, and sometimes the guy who bought Action Comics number 1 in 1980 for $10,000, you know, is you know, that's worth $3 million now, you know, so who knows? I have absolutely no idea, but I do know this, we're ready to start bringing some of you lovely audience members up on stage and start talking to you about the treasures that you've brought for us. Maybe we'll all learn something. And so let's bring Alex F. up here. Alex has brought something hilarious that I really want to talk about, so... Here he comes. Big hand for Alex, everybody. A sedate Sunday night hand for Alex. Here, sit down.
Right here, Alex?
Yes. Well, first of all, you've got a PlayStation Messenger bag, which is pretty sweet.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got that from the Gear Store. Is this on?
Is it? You can use that one, and you don't have to go in too close.
Sure, right here too.
Okay.
Yeah, I got that from the Gear Store. It's really neat. It's also perfect, like, for an extra bag because I never take carry on when I travel.
Yes.
It's perfect for that. So what I brought is.
It's wrapped up in a shirt.
Yeah, I don't have it unboxed, but I have a Gizmondo.
Yeah.
Who remembers one of those? Anybody? Ooh, we got some hands up. Yay for your obscurity! Woo!
We don't have to plug in the Gizmondo. It's okay. It's not even. It's also the European version. Something's gonna get fried. No, it's okay. We don't have to.
It's a dual voltage adapter.
Oh, okay.
So
I'm gonna go ahead and say we don't have to plug in the Gizmondo. It's all right. No. I trust you that we're gonna say let's assume the Gizmondo functions.
Kind of. The battery doesn't work anymore. They don't hold a charge anymore, and you can't get new ones.
Well, yeah, just send it to the Gizmondo factory, and sure, so, fix that right up for you.
So
I think all the people who made the system are in jail.
So I think I can speak a little bit about this, and anybody can jump in.
I'll let you go for it.
So I like the obscure Gizmondo. What, mid 2000s?
2005, I think.
2005. And so this came out after the N-Gage.
It's not often you can describe the entire lifespan of a system in 1 year.
And really what it was is there was a whole thriving movement to, like, make the next-gen portable gaming system that could do everything. You know, it could do multi-functions, share some capabilities of a computer, but still play games and be awesome. And I don't think Gizmondo did any of that right, but the truth of the matter is there was a limited library. It's important to know that none of the batteries work for the system. They just don't. And so this particular unit is in decent shape. One thing on a portable, I always check the screen. You know, if the screen's scratched up, that's going to take away from value. This has some dirt on it, but it doesn't look like it's scratched. It looks like that could be cleaned. Looks in fairly decent shape. Can I open up the battery compartment?
Yep.
The other thing you want to always check on a portable system is, you know, the insides. Now, if I remember correctly, these won't corrode because of the type of battery they are.
They will?
They won't.
Oh, they won't.
They
won't. Okay.
They will not. Like Game & Watch.
Yeah. Okay.
So, that's in the fact that you have still the original battery, whether it works or not, is a good thing.
Yeah, and the battery back.
You know, are you looking for, like, kind of a ballpark?
I'm just curious. I collect handhelds. I have no desire to really sell my collection ever, but it's just a neat thing to.
So he also brought up three games, Fat Hammer Classics, and it's important to know that. Can I open this up?
Yeah.
Okay. And so the Gizmondo carts are very small, kind of like a Vita card.
They're basically SD cards.
Yeah, and they're complete. Fat Hammer Classics. The name of the game is called Sticky Balls.
It's a family classic.
And looks like it's complete too. I do believe the games you brought are common. They're not the some of the more obscure ones. And then Richard Burns Rally, which I'm going to go out on a limb and say it's a racing game. And so at least on the system itself, I would, you know, definitely in the ballpark, probably, I don't know. You can take a look at. So I'd say like probably $100 to $150 range, you know, definitely, depending on how you sold it with the games. Something like this, you know, with games, especially that's so uncommon, you're going to get more value by putting the games with the system. Trying to sell it separately with this, not going to work. If you have a rare game, always bundle it in with the system. It's easier to sell. And people are going to be more inclined, and especially because they want to get it all in one shot. That might be the last time they see a Gizmondo. I've rarely seen one in person. I've always seen them online. I went to, I think, Fry's after they were clearancing out and got some games. But it's definitely
yeah,
rare.
From what I've seen online, it looks like what little they sold, the vast majority of it was in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I have one with a UK adapter on it.
Yeah,
I mean, it was the company was based in the UK, I believe, or whatever.
I was like Florida,
whatever
or something.
Whatever shell company they were using to run this scam,
that's
basically.
Cool,
I didn't know.
So I mean, I think a lot of the units were. I mean, I think it was just one unit that was like, you know, they sold the European ones wherever with the adapter, kind of as you have. Yeah.
Another thing I'm curious about: is there any way to tell which ones had like? The systems, when they came out, there's two versions. One was going to have ads on it that was cheaper.
Right.
And then one was going to have,
it
was going to be more expensive, but no ads. But they never ever had the ads work.
I believe what happened was, yes, they sold the systems with the ads versus no ads, and then they never got the ad program off the ground at all. So, yeah. Nobody won with the Gizmondo. I actually, this is bringing back a lot of memories. This is a true story. I'm going to tell you this story. I went to the Gizmondo launch party.
I've seen photos of that. It is insane.
And not the London one where they like hired like million, billion-dollar entertainers. Just the crappier San Francisco
with all the
one.
Like the models holding the Gizmondo.
Oh yeah. No. Just the United States one.
Yeah.
But even then, it was just everybody was there just going, okay.
So I just noticed something in here kind of interesting, and so can you tell me about this? So
there's a demo card. It came with my system. It has I think a demo of Trailblazer, maybe. I think it's the game with like you control like a ball and you like grow down like a track. It's got like it was in my system when I got it.
It's got a demo card on that, so I don't know if that was bundled with the system.
Right.
I think it was.
Okay.
So
cool that you have it again.
Yeah, I would probably say in the 100-150 range for the whole mm-hmm. package, because the Gizmondo doesn't have the box, right? It's very rare. Cool. It's rare as all heck, but zero demand. If there's ever a Gizmondo craze, you know what I mean? You're sitting pretty.
I hope I'm still alive for that Gizmondo craze. Sounds great.
Yes.
So I think that's important to know that you can have something rare. That doesn't mean it's worth anything because mm-hmm. you have to have people that actually want it, you know. And so, but it's worth something. It's worth something to the right person. It's probably worth more online than in person. And that's my final thoughts on it.
Yeah, I know just like sometimes like I collect some weird, obscure stuff. The one thing I'm trying to get now is complete collection of Koi Pasogo games, and like they're impossible to find, and there's like some, I think like a couple of people have emailed me wanting to collect them too, so now there's like two of us trying to collect stuff.
Uh-oh.
And now I'm like fighting with these people for like the once or twice a year something shows up on Yahoo Japan auctions.
Yeah, collecting stuff that's not native to the country you're in is very challenging sometimes, especially what you mentioned. Anyway, at least you're not an idiot and collect N-Gage stuff.
Oh, I have that too.
Well, Alex, thank you very much for coming.
I have a complete set. That's why I said that.
Right, yeah. Complete N-Gage set?
Mm-hmm.
Of course you did.
Thank you so much for bringing it up. Just give him a hand.
All right, Kirkwin, come on up. He's been to the show numerous times.
Give him a hand.
Kirkwin, here he is.
Cool.
Hi.
Hi, have a seat. I see a lot of yellow. I see a lot of Pikachu in my future.
I well, brought my Pokemon. Let me show you them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I got the
original. This has been cared and loved for.
Yep.
Until that. Can I open it up?
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I always want to make sure. You know, yes.
Oh, mm-hmm. It got even better.
Yep.
Bad idea. Place?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just in case you guys want to power it up. I brought
it. Game Boy Power Adapter, nice.
I don't see a lot of other people with this one, but I also brought the gold silver version.
Nice shape too. Look at that. Ooh.
So these are the I know it's
the my, special edition
for the, for those of you in the back. Yes, they're both Pokemon special edition Game Boys. There's a Game Boy and, like, Color, and there's a Game Boy. Yeah. Are they both Game Boy Colors?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Both Game Boy Colors.
And I brought all the games.
So Pokemon Yellow. Really, really nice shape.
Another Pokemon Yellow.
Ooh, damn.
I actually bought two of them.
Pokemon Blue, Pokemon Red, and the carts are in really nice shape. They have his name initialed on it, but yeah, what's cool about it is he didn't put the initials on the label. He was smart and did it below. Yeah.
That's good.
Very cool. Very nice of you.
Hold there. So I can say, I do find myself in the situation where, like, somebody has written their name on a cartridge. I hesitate to say this, but I will say this with a big old asterisk next to it. Mr. Clean Magic Eraser, which you have to understand, a Mr. Clean Magic Eraser is an abrasive. It is like a super, super, super fine sandpaper. If all else fails, you know what I mean? And if it's Sharpie on a cartridge, everything else will fail. I will take a Mr. Clean Magic Eraser and go very, very gently over the Sharpie, like, on the cartridge. It will remove, you know, some, you know, microscopic bits of the cartridge, you know what I mean? It's taking off the Sharpie, and some cartridge will come along with it. You won't be able to see it. But if you take a Mr. Clean Magic Eraser and your cartridge and you go like that, you'll take the you'll like take the texture off the cartridge. Like if you look at like an N64 cartridge or an NES cartridge, they're sort of finely textured. They're not smooth, right? But if you take a Mr. Clean Magic Eraser and go like this, you're gonna smooth them down. So you don't want to go crazy. But like sometimes if there's a name Sharpied on there, just a little bit and it'll come right off and it'll look great. And I say this because, like, it is dangerous to take an abrasive thing to a collectible in any case. So, you know, make your own decisions.
Also, the case is in really nice shape. Took good care of that. Inside, it's not discolored or
it's
anything.
It's got the foam in there.
Foam in there. It's got the
your Game Boy.
Link cable?
Yeah,
the Game Boy. Link cable. Very nice shape.
So, Kinsey, you're in and out of video game stores here in Seattle a lot. You see a lot of what's going on with prices, especially right now. I mean, this is really the illustration of what I was saying about awareness and demand, right? Because Pokemon Go has absolutely made people think, oh, yeah, Pokemon. Mm-hmm. And prices have gone nuts, right?
They really have, and especially starting with just the first-gen Pokemon, that gets the, like, nostalgia going. You know, I mean, like, I love Pokemon, but I love Pokemon a la 1996, 1997. So, if they would have started Pokemon Go with all the Pokemon, I would not have cared as much. So I feel like I'm not the only one who feels that way. And, I mean, the older Pokemon games have definitely spiked. I don't know if it's directly because of Pokemon Go, probably, maybe, but it's one of those nostalgia bubbles that's just happening right now. And, I mean,
it was a spark.
Yeah.
It sparked like, oh, I remember that.
Exactly. So now just like, you know, cart-only Game Boy Pokemon games are going anywhere from like 40 to 75, depending on the title.
Yeah, like Yellow right now is like, what, 50, 60 bucks?
Yep.
Even more, just like the cartridge, just like that.
Mm-hmm.
If the battery works. I mean, that's always a concern with Pokemon cartridges, especially because sometimes the batteries die.
I'm pretty sure like some of the battery saves are dead now.
Yeah.
So. And that can be fixed, but the other thing is most, and you can attest to this, most copies don't come into the store that look like this. I mean, this
right.
label
a lot
is
of them
really
are,
nice
is
shape.
It really good?
Yeah.
You can't even see, like, on the Yellow, I mean, holding it sideways, I'm not seeing a single scratch on the front label. Mm. And it is pristine.
Yeah.
It is really nice shape.
Thank you. I actually do still have the boxes. I didn't bring them with me because they're like kind of compressed in another box.
Yeah, and that definitely adds to the value because I see you have the instruction manuals as well and all the ads that went in it is what it looks like from here. So.
Yeah.
Right. The instruction manuals are really, really nice shape. They look really good. I mean, so as they sit, I mean, a yellow could be like $70 card. Having the manual along with a loose cartridge doesn't really change the value that much, unfortunately. It adds a few dollars, but it doesn't go crazy. But when you have the box and the manual together with a cartridge, I mean, then like, I mean, everything has got to be $100 now, right? I mean, at that point,
definitely.
Like any copy of Pokemon Yellow, Red, Blue, Silver, Gold in the box with the manual is got to be about $100.
Yep. Definitely, if not more. Yeah, depending on the condition. So, and even like the Game Boy Colors, which I collect all the Pokemon variant Game Boy Colors and SPs.
Then you are our expert for this round.
They're also shooting up in price, but it's funny because they're very similar price to the game.
Really?
You know, so it's like these Game Boy Colors, you might see at a retro store anywhere from like $85 to $100. So they're really, really close to the game itself, which is kind of funny.
And neither of these, I mean, these are both, you know, sort of they're decked out with Pokemon characters, but neither of those are the like, oh, it was only sold in the Pokemon Center in Japan.
No.
Kind of thing. These were on shelves in the U.S.
I think this one might have been the Toys R Us exclusive, but other than that, yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Look at the back. Oh, yeah. So the other thing, again, this matters to me, is it has the backing that matches this system.
Mm-hmm.
And so if that's missing, it would be worth less. Inside the battery compartment, anything that has batteries, you need to check it. It's clean. There isn't any corrosion. It's super nice in there. You took well care of this.
Thank you.
I'm really glad you brought this. Mm-hmm.
I do think one thing we should mention about Pokemon games especially, and I think you guys might already know where I'm going with this, but they are probably the biggest faked Game Boy games out there. Yeah. Like, it's insane.
Yep. Yep. Well, The big fakes are the Game Boy Advance version.
Yes.
Right? Because nobody, I always hesitate to say nobody's faking this, but I don't see fakes of Game Boy Black and White or Game Boy Color. I see, like, I see bootleg ones.
Yes.
But, like, I don't see, like, obvious, like, or like, counterfeits of those games. Game Boy Advance, I mean, they're pumping those out of China as we speak. Like, that's something to really, really watch out for.
I wanted to add that while I don't see many fakes of the original, I see a lot of fake labels. And so what people are doing is taking, because the labels are now fading, scratching, so people know they can get more value. You can buy a replacement label for these pretty inexpensively, and people are doing that and putting the fake label on an original cart because they know they can get more money that way.
And that's in really, like, being able to tell real from fake if you're going to be spending, like, actual money on stuff is really important. If you go to conventions, one piece of advice I can say is if you go to conventions, look for people who are selling, like, repros of, like, games that never came out in the U.S. You know, sometimes, like, you know, Final Fantasy V on, you know, it'll be on a Super Nintendo cartridge and it'll have a label on it. Those sort of, like, aftermarket labels for those types of repro games you'd see at a convention are going to be the same kind of labels that somebody is going to use to try to fake a Super Nintendo game. So go to a convention, look at real Super Nintendo games, then look at the repro Super Nintendo games, compare and contrast and get a feel for, okay, the next time I see a label, I'm going to be able to tell if it's real or fake because I've kind of looked at this. Because that personal experience is really important, because what you don't want to, and I see this online all the time, I see people posting like, hey guys, I have the opportunity to buy this game. Here's a picture of it. Is this fake? And it's like, you need to walk away, because if you're trying to, like, decide if something is real or fake at the moment that you're about to pay money for it, like, you're about to get ripped off, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, the detail, the quality, the lettering on the actual label, if it's blurred anywhere, typically, especially on Game Boy stuff, it's
fake. Right.
Yeah, if Nintendo spelled wrong, you know, the little clues.
Yeah. Sorny.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a, I mean, it's a great Pokemon collection. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely at the height of the craze of the value right now. And so we didn't really cover the carrying cases either, which honestly, again, like, you know, a couple of years ago, I would say not worth very much money at all. But like, mm-hmm. honestly, right now, just considering how hot Pokemon is, I mean, the smaller one, which I think you said has a little bit more wear to it, yeah. has been mm-hmm. has been very clearly used.
And loved.
Yeah. I mean, probably in like the, I mean, you know, if in a great day, like the $30 to $40 range, like at a store. This one is so nice, and it's so beautiful. You know, everything is so nice on it. I don't know. I mean, maybe even more. Maybe in the $50 to $60 area. Just
I think
for,
you can get that. I think yeah. it's in really nice shape, and I'm really glad that you brought this up.
I mean, these yeah, are not you. Those are not things people kept. You know what yeah. I mean? These got thrown away, even if the video games got kept.
Yeah, I just saw an original Pokemon backpack, and yeah. it went for, I think it was $55, so wow. probably not far off on yeah. that one.
Well, that was really cool. Thanks for bringing it up, Erwin. Giving us an opportunity to talk about something topical. Joel M., are you out there? Who else? And so after Joel will be Wing C. And then after Wing C, Dan, I know you're here. Has anybody else brought stuff for the panel? Do, 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 do. Nope. Okay. That's fine. We're really good at improv.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Joel M.? Oh, there you are. In the shadows.
Right. Let's give him a hand.
Hello.
I think this is for Chris.
Oh. This is a bunch of moon language. It's all written in, this is some intense, I study Japanese, this is some intense kanji on the front of this, but it's all written in Romaji on here, so it's Bakumatsu Roman Daini Maku Gekka no Kenshi, final edition.
Last Blade.
Oh, Last Blade?
Yeah.
Gotcha, okay. Yeah. So it is Last Blade for the imported Dreamcast, you can pass yep. it on to everybody else there.
Final edition, and this is the variant cover.
Oh.
So I've not seen another one.
What I noticed is Playmore is on the front of this, and at Playmore, as you know, took over SNK. I don't know all the details, but you know, Playmore began producing and running the company.
Mm-hmm. So is that the variation? The fact that it says Playmore, and or is it a different piece of art?
No, I think that was that's the first Neo Geo game for the Dreamcast that had the Playmore logo on it.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But I don't. So what is I don't the think variation? There was a split. The other cover is I forget the character's name, but
oh, okay.
It's one of the male characters. It's a shot from behind and a large background. I've got the J card in it too. In fact, I actually bought the same game again because I couldn't read it, thinking it was Last Blade 2. And here it's like, oh no, this is just a. This is the
okay.
regular cover of a game I bought years ago.
Got it, okay.
Gorgeous shape.
Okay. All right. It oddly is, the SNK releases for the Dreamcast don't work on the VGA adapter. So that's mildly annoying if you're a Dreamcast collector.
Really? Yes. Just the SNK stuff doesn't
Just
work with the
SNK
VGA adapter?
Stuff. Yep. So like Mark of the Wolves and Last Blade doesn't work with the VGA adapter, but it will work with the S-card connector. So,
okay.
If you've got an upscaler like a XRGB or something.
That VGA adapter for the Sega Dreamcast is worth some money, right? Because there was an official Sega one that really makes the Dreamcast look about as beautiful as the Dreamcast is going to get, right?
Yeah, yeah, and it could be worse. It could be a Neo Geo X.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, no, it is, I'm mostly a North American collector, but it's in gorgeous shape.
It is in really nice shape. A lot of Japanese stuff is in really nice shape because everybody kept it in really good shape and everybody took a little spine card and, you know, unfolded it nice and flat and, you know, inserted it in there. So there's no damage whatsoever. I'm gonna say you stumped me because I've never seen this game in like the glass cases of Akihabara. So it's like, I don't think it's one of the big rares on Japanese Dreamcast. It's probably in the $30-ish range, but I don't know about the variant cover and how things would change that. What do you think? I know that's totally just, you know, role reversal here, but
no, that's probably I would guess about right.
Okay.
The non-variant cover of it, I believe it was, you know, close to $20 maybe with the exchange rate.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So a variant cover may not be much more. Now I think I knew the AES cart of this is like $1,500 or something.
And that's seen, and but, I mean there's so much going on here because yes, so I mean Neo Geo AES, which is the home version of the Neo Geo, is I mean it was always expensive. All the games on it were always expensive, but they're starting to go up. And then what's also happening right now is that MVS or the arcade cartridges for the Neo Geo having languished, being worth very little for a long time comparatively, are now starting to go up. I think more people are buying like those consoleized MVS, which is like the Neo Geo arcade hardware, and they put it in a little box you can attach to your TV and just play the arcade cartridges. More people are getting those. So many people are not collecting Neo Geo Home because it's so expensive, and they're like, oh, well, I'll just collect MVS instead, and then that shoots that price up because everybody's getting into that.
Which is pirated quite a bit now.
Yeah.
And same thing is happening with the Sega Saturn, because everybody is like, I don't want to collect U.S. Sega Saturn because, I mean, the price gulfs now. Like, Shining Wisdom is, like, one of the cheapest games on the Sega Saturn in Japan. And in the U.S., it is one of the most expensive games in the Sega Saturn. So you even have people now just going, I'm just going to collect Japanese Sega Saturn stuff. And now that's starting to go up, too, because everybody's collecting Japanese Sega Saturn stuff. And honestly, in a few years, something very similar may happen with Dreamcast, because Dreamcast is starting to get that sort of, like, retro cachet as well.
I didn't bring it, but I do have Samurai Spirit, Samurai Showdown, the Japanese Saturn edition with the RAM cart and all the...
Oh, right.
Nice.
And
yep.
Everything in it. The box is worn, but...
Saturn was always really known for its fighting games, and so that's what's starting to go up on the Saturn now. It's like, especially the additions that are in the boxes with the RAM cartridge, like you said. Yeah.
Yep.
Any insight from your end on the Sega Dreamcast?
Well, it's always kind of interesting. It happens on like the Dreamcast and like the Super Famicom. Like you can normally get the Japanese versions of titles like way cheaper. So, which is really, really nice if you're looking for that one title that's like $1 million.
Yeah.
Just get the Japanese one.
Yep. I slept on, you know, Japanese Magical Chase. Because, I mean, you could go to Japan, you could get Magical Chase, which is in the U.S., you know, as John was talking about, it's the rarest, TurboGrafx-16 mm-hmm. game. In Japan, it was always like, you know, $100, which, you know, that's expensive, but it, you know, wasn't bad compared to like, you know, thousands of dollars for the U.S. version. But I was just like, whatever. Nope, now everybody is now switching. I mean, even you were saying, like, you're starting to buy PC Engine, right?
Yep.
The Japanese version of the TurboGrafx-16. Mm-hmm. Everybody's doing that now, so now even Japanese Magical Chase is, like, $500. So I, like, totally missed the window on that. Yep. Yeah. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joel.
Thank you.
Wing C is out there. Wing C is out there with stuff. Hello. Come on up. Oh, he didn't have to go the long way. It's okay. No. March of Shame. Okay.
So I'm going to show you so N64 just celebrated 20 years.
N64 just celebrated 20 years.
Any N64 collectors out there?
Yeah.
So this is the first poster to debut the N64 in Japan. So it's over 20 years, and it was at the Shoshinkai show. To announce the Shoshinkai show.
Holy cow. So, how'd you get this?
When I was a kid, or not a kid, but a teenager, I tried to be in the game industry, and I made friends with a lot of people, including some representatives from Nintendo who just came back from the show. And they said, you want this poster? And they gave it, and it was like taped up that, you know, at the show, and they take it down after the show. But he got me a really nice... it's actually been on my wall, so it's a little bit wear and tear, but still, I have never seen anything on the internet about it. I've been looking for information about it, but this is it.
Well, let's talk about it. Yeah. Okay, so when we're talking about posters and material like this, we're talking about what is the subject matter, what is the condition, and sort of a you know, looking at the cross section of those two things to see what the price is going to be. Keep it away from the pitcher of water.
Yeah.
No, don't move it. Oh my God.
I was going to move it over here. I was going to move it down here.
It wasn't doing anything. Sitting there.
Okay. Sorry. Sorry.
Now it's worthless. No.
Sorry.
So in this case, yes, you are absolutely right. The Nintendo 64 was unveiled at the Shoshinkai show in Tokyo in 1995, which is the correct year. Came out in 1996, but this was the year that they had it there for the first time. I think they had it's got the sort of original like prototype version of the controller with the really wide control stick on it. And they had Mario 64. And they had Kirby Bowl, which was going to be the sequel to Kirby's Dream Course on Super Nintendo.
I love Kirby's Dream Course.
Which didn't actually come out, right? And then they sort of retooled it into Kirby's Air Ride, which didn't come out for the N64. So there was a lot of stuff going on there. But I think those might have been the only two playable games at that show. And so, yes, absolutely. That is, you are correct about what this is. And of course, I'm kind of taking your word for it that the story that you can just print this out on your computer, basically. But it looks really good.
It looks original.
You don't have, as far as I can see, there's no major damage to this. There's a ding. There's a thumbtack, you know, on the back. You didn't put it up with thumbtacks, basically. So good on teenage you for not doing that. and in general, it is in nice displayable condition. I would say take this sucker down and get it framed, right? Which would be a great way to make sure that it's, you know, stays in this good condition. And, you know, don't have sunlight on it. This is tough because you don't just go onto eBay and look up Space World 1995. You know, poster and find the value. I just have to think about like what's popular right now. What have previous things sold for? Would somebody want to put this up in their man cave, basically, or woman cave, or non-binary cave? I don't want to exclude anyone. If I had to take all of those things into consideration. I think this is really hot. I think that given the subject matter and where it's from, that N64 collecting is on the rise, all of that kind of stuff all taken into consideration, it's probably at least a $300 to $400 poster, if not more, to the right buyer. I mean, it's really, really something special.
And it's because I would add to that too. A specific event. This is not a poster that was mass produced. It wasn't something that went from country to country. It was a specific event. That poster happened, and that event happened at one time.
A lot of posters that you see go up for sale are usually advertisements. So it's the ones that are like, you know, the ones that were hanging in Toys R Us is normally the ones that go up for sale. And, you know, some of those are harder to find than others, but I think you're right. This is definitely something special, and it's awesome.
Yeah, cool that you brought that here.
It does. I mean, yeah. Again, I mean, you could have a poster from a trade show that like doesn't have very good art on it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Or just is sort of a mishmash, or is art that you'd see elsewhere. But honestly, people really are looking for stuff like this, like retail standees. You know, that's mm-hmm. about good games. I mean, this has got. You know, it's got the Nintendo 64 logo, it's got the, you know, it's got the Mario freaking out over the N64.
And the analog stick looks different on the poster. That's so cool. And that, I think, adds to the value because it timestamps it. Hey, we didn't have the controller finalized, and this is what we think it's going to look like, or this is what currently was look like, and what's really neat that it's different than the actual analog stick. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Definitely.
Right.
And even...
Oh, they're not labeled?
Yeah.
No. Yeah. Yep. Yep.
They're not. That's
yeah. Good.
See, now so, I just want to find that controller is what I want.
Oh.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's really beautiful. Yeah. I mean, thank you for bringing it in. I would say, yeah, I mean, it's really in the, yeah, somewhere between $1 and $1,000, probably somewhere in the middle of that. Yeah, no, like, but like multiple hundreds of dollars very, very easily to the right person who knows what it is and would appreciate it, you know, kind of hanging up.
So I have one more item.
Okay.
And this has been in the, just been on the news or in the internet recently.
Oh, really?
It's a blue N64 DD disc.
Man, we're going from strength to strength here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, go for it.
Do you want to roll? You can roll up the poster.
I won't get any water
on
it, I promise.
Kind of,
yeah, these have been extremely topical lately.
What are these?
So.
What is this? Why don't you tell me?
I'm sure a lot of people have seen it. It's been picked up by every internet outlet ever. But local collector and YouTube star Metal Jesus Rocks, which you might know us from, he recently found a 64 disk drive US prototype. And these are the discs that it takes. And the 64 disk drive never came out in America because it was like, didn't do so hot in Japan. It was like mail order only. And it was like this huge flop that like they decided not to release it here. So the only US units there are going to be the dev units. So yeah, that just happened. But one thing that's kind of interesting about these is since... like, the blue discs are, a lot of these are the development discs. But it really, the value is really in what is on the disc.
Yes.
If it's blank, it's still a really cool collector's item.
And it's,
but like,
and it's worth money. I mean,
it's worth money. I'm not saying it's like $0. But but if it has that, like, Mother 3 on it, that's, it might add to the value a little bit, so.
Yeah, and
well, that would be the absolute, like, the top end of the, because, you know, Mother 3 was a sequel to Earthbound, and it came out of the Game Boy Advance, but originally it was in development for the Nintendo 64 DD, and they got pretty far, and so.
It's on one of those discs somewhere.
Exactly, it's like, there might be one, and that would, I mean, if literally, if I was holding this, and does it have Mother 3 on it?
No.
So if this checking. I mean, if I was holding this and had Mother 3 on it, I mean, there'd probably be multiple people here at PAX who would, like, offer $2,000 to $3,000 or more or much
possibly
more.
Possibly way more than that.
Just to get, actually, the fan gamer guys would probably, you know, trade.
Yeah, if it was Mother 3, it'd be worth more than that.
Right. Do you know what's on the disc? Have you been able to?
I believe it's blank.
Okay.
I'm going to say that.
Yeah.
But I don't have a 64 DVD.
Right.
Yeah.
And recently, some were discovered that were blank.
Yeah.
And so they're really the probability of having something on a blue disc so far has been low.
Yeah.
But there is, I do believe, there's some out there that do have content on them.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that have been just recently discovered, it's being low on content.
Yeah, a lot of them end up being like test discs. Mm-hmm. So to kind of test out the system, like a lot of Nintendo test carts are really collectible, for example, and. It'd be even awesome if there was something like that on there, but I would actually highly recommend that you reach out to Metal Jesus Rocks while he has, like, the cartridge that he found that'll help read these discs.
Yeah, have you tried to read this?
Yes.
Okay. So we're, it's blank, right?
Okay.
So still worth something.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I mean, I personally would pay you like $200 for it, which means it's worth way more than that, right?
So, yeah. I mean, there's not many of these found, especially the blue discs. You know, so definitely you have something that, you know, is in very limited production.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, you do want to watch out with stuff like that because, like, again, they were considering releasing this in the U.S. Somebody might have a closet full of blank blue discs. You know what I mean? Like, those might get out and it might tank the value. You know, you never really know, like, with this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, probably in the multiple hundreds of dollar range just for one of them. On the low end of that because it is blank and it's really, like, it's this very specific group of, like, you know, hardcore weird Nintendo collectors. Not that the
those
collectors
are
weird, but the... Well, the collectors of weird Nintendo stuff, which is kind of where I'm at in my personal sort of collecting area right now. Yeah. Yeah, well, thanks very much. That poster is crazy.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you.
So Dan here, who's coming up, was like came in and he said, I have some items. And I'm like, okay, great. And he goes, but I left him in the hotel. Can I go run? This is like 10 minutes before the show started. I'm like, yeah, if you want to, but
And he made it back in time.
And he made it back in time.
Let's give him a hand.
Yay! Welcome.
Hello. Well, first, I actually wanted to start. I had a question for the panel. Over at Pink Gorilla,
yeah,
they have in the case, it kind of caught my eye. I didn't know this, but there was a version of Snatcher made in a US version for the Sega CD, and they have it there, and it shocked me. It's priced, they have it for $300. I was just wondering what you guys thought about that, and
so it's
just a little bit of history, maybe.
And it's disc only. That's the important thing. It's yeah. only mm-hmm. the it's only the disc for the Sega CD. Yeah, John.
Well, Snatcher. We'll kind of rewind. Is sometimes the distribution of a game can really factor in on why a game's valuable. Throw in that the game is awesome. And that compounds the problem because you have a game that's hard to find, and then it's awesome to play. And so Snatcher is just a fantastic game, kind of hard to explain. I mean, but it's sought after, and it's amazing. And there really isn't a game like Snatcher. I mean, it's unique gameplay. That price is correct. That price is correct. That game
yes.
skyrocketed.
And it's nuts that it's, I mean, again, like, cartridge only, when you just have a cartridge and you don't have the box, you know, that can get expensive. But in general, like, just loose discs for anything, for the longest time, were very, very, undervalued. There were very few loose discs that would sell for very much money at all. And now we're really starting to see those prices explode. I mean, Snatcher, full in the case with the manual and everything, is way past 500 now,
yeah.
right?
Yeah,
I mean, it's way up there.
And correct me if I'm wrong, Chris and Kinsey, it wasn't ported to anything else.
In the United States,
there was only one version of it, and that's the Sega CD version.
Yep, and it hasn't been re-released in any capacity. It's a Hideo Kojima game. Like, it's, it is that perfect intersection of they didn't make very many of them, and it is an awesome game that people really want to play.
One of my craziest scores in my game collection, I found one in a pawn store for a couple bucks sealed.
Yes.
And it's a grail in my collection.
That's pretty crazy, yeah.
And I have the original KB Toys price sticker still on it.
Yep.
Yeah.
But that's not what you brought. That's just the thing you brought.
I just thought.
That's just a question.
Just
yes.
Thought to make an interesting conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so this is going to be boring, is what you're saying? I don't think so. All right. So you brought a couple of games that are absolutely going up in price right
mm-hmm.
now. Yep.
Mega Man Legends 2. Don't see this copy that often. Definitely.
No. So, of course, yeah, Mega Man Legends.
That one I found in a local store.
Oh, cool. Original price sticker? Original receipt? Sorry.
That might actually be the receipt when I bought it. Okay. Yeah, it is.
That's awesome. Keep that. No, let's keep that. I'm a big fan of keeping all the receipts and paperwork because it timestamps it. And I'm also a fan, by the way, if it was an old rental store, and that rental store is long gone. I actually keep the rental store on it because that archive, that may be the only thing left of that rental store. So I'm big on preservation, and that extends to the place where the game was purchased.
So the Mega Man Legends series is definitely one that people enjoy owning on the PlayStation 1. So the prices on those have been going up. Mega Man Legends 1, they made tons of, and that was really hovering down in the $20 or even less area for a while. Like, there were a lot of sealed ones out there still, you know, for a long time, like in the 2000s. Now it's starting to go up. Mega Man Legends 2 is starting to go up. The big one is The Misadventures of Tronbon, the third game in the series, which is now like a $300, $400 PS1 game in complete condition.
I'm regretting still passing that up. It was like 80.
Too.
And I was like, $80.
Yeah, I could have bought it. I could have bought it long ago. I'm like, meh.
But Mega Man Legends 2, I think at this point in that condition, 70 to 80. Yep. And rising, honestly. I mean,
yeah.
PlayStation is like, is just entering its sort of, you know, glory period of people wanting to play PS1 games again, you know, so.
Next game is Rule of Rose.
Another one that's
PS2.
Shot up. And when you want to talk about games that were, like, limited quantity, like, produced, Atlas is kind of.
That is their business
that's
model.
What they do.
Yeah.
Niche gaming.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a, I actually reviewed this game. It was really good. I mean, it was janky, but, you know, like, in the good way, you know what I mean? Like, it was really weird. It's a survival horror game. You're in, like, an all-girls school. It is really weird. Actually, weirdly, I never got from Atlas, like, a retail, like, a production copy of it. It just had the, like, the reviewable, like, disc. A couple of years ago, I went to a flea market and found it sealed.
Nice.
For like $30. So
yeah, there you
go. That was a great deal for me at the time, and just owning that now. That's way over $200 now in that condition. It's PlayStation 2, there's not very many games that are like worth a ton of money, but I think that's on the top end of PS2 right now.
And yeah. I think Rule of Rose is one of those games too. It's kind of steadily gone up. I think every time I've seen it, like, at a convention, when I see the price, it surprises me, I think, every single time. I remember when it hit, like, 80, and then it was 150, and I'm just like, what?
Wait. Yep. I have seen it more than once, and then the very last night I saw it back in March, I was like, oh, I better pick this up. So that's why I have it now, because I just kept on seeing it, and I saw it was really high in value, so then I researched it, and I thought, well, this is one of the more rare PS2 games, so I...
Definitely.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, the nice thing about PlayStation 2 right now, if you kind of educate yourself about PS2, like, you can go into your local record store sometimes, and they'll have PlayStation 2 or original Xbox or maybe even GameCube games, and they'll still sell them. And sometimes you want to find the places that, like, don't care about price, you know? They buy it for 50 cents, they sell them all for $2, you know, you can still find gems that are actually worth quite a bit of money sometimes. In odd places, just because PlayStation 2 is still so relatively recent. Like, you might find it in record stores, or, you know, you might go into thrift stores where somebody might have already been in there and bought all the NES games, but there might still be a ton of PS2 games on the shelf. Like,
you
can still have those hits, you know, of finding really valuable stuff on a thrift store with PS2 and Xbox if you're going to sit there and, you know, look at all of the DVDs on the shelf.
It's all about the window of time. You know, you can't wait too long, because then everybody's looking for it. But if it's just a couple systems past, 2-3 generations, and people have forgotten about it but haven't thought about recollecting it, that's the time to really swoop up and collect something, if you're into it. And PlayStation 2 is definitely there.
You know, and you were collecting in the 90s, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you were in the 90s. I mean, you were literally going out there and building big collections of games and buying stuff. And you, at that time, were crazy.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
If people, it'd be like if I was filling my house with stacks of old newspapers.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Laughed
like,
people laughed
would be
at me.
Like, yeah, people would be like, why are you doing this? You
especially
are,
for Genesis.
You are filling your house with garbage.
Yeah.
And now who's laughing?
Yeah.
They did. They especially
got to the stadium
laughed.
Events. Yeah.
Thank
All
you
right.
for bringing that. Thank
yes,
you.
Thank you so much, Jen. So it is basically 10 p.m., so we are basically done. So we want to thank you guys all for coming out to Retro Game Roadshow this year. Hope you enjoyed yourselves. Thanks to everybody who brought fun stuff in. We really always, as always, we appreciate you guys giving us the opportunity to do this and bringing the stuff in from your collections, giving us something to talk about. Another big hand for our panelists, Seattle's very own John Hamm, Happy Pittsburgh.
Thank you.
You can always, if you go to the Seattle Retro Gaming Expo next year, you'll see them there. You'll probably see me there, too. Thank you guys very much for coming, and have a good night. Have a good rest of your PAX. Thank you.